everybody. I really don't know if I have to shout. If I talk in a normal voice, can you still hear me? Oh, this is weird. Okay, good. So, good morning, everybody. This is a talk called It's a Small World After All. And what I will be addressing is that I think that in the future, 5 to 10 years, we will be developing faster, in actually much shorter cycles, much shorter than you think you are doing now, mostly. And we will build much smaller components. And I'll try to give you some sort of historical perspective on that too. And I will show you what will happen and what I think we should do in this field to be able to deal with our challenges. So who am I? My name is Sander. I'm an independent consultant. I'm currently working as the CTO of a company that builds products for the insurance market. Before that, I was the CTO, also as an independent consultant, of an insurance company. And before that, I worked for this really little company called Capgemini for about a decade, and I was one of their global agile thought leaders. So I visited many agile and many failing agile projects around the world, looked at them and tried to investigate what happened. Basically, what I do, I'm a programmer. I've been writing code for 35 years already. So that's probably longer than most of you are on this planet. But that means I'm a really old guy. Yes, I know. This is my Twitter tag and my GitHub account, which I should add more stuff to it anyway. So here we go. OK, oh yeah, and I've written a couple of books. If you're not Dutch, they don't really matter, besides the one in German and in English. And I'm working on two new ones as well, one on microservices and one about the topic that I'll be discussing today. So now we really go. So as you can see that we are in a fast-changing field, right? And it has been changing, and it has been changing fast for the last 50 years, because that's about the age of the field that we're in. But I think that it will change faster and faster and faster and faster. That is not a linear scale. It will be, or it is, an exponential scale to how things are changing. So a bit of history. This is Moore's Law. You all know Moore's Law, right? You've seen this before. Basically, Moore's Law says the number of transistors in a dense integrated circuit doubles approximately every 2 years. Now, if you look at the line, this looks linear. It isn't, right? Double every 2 years means it actually, well, it goes up like this from your perspective, right? That means the possibilities that we have technology-wise, double every 2 years. And the question is, how are we dealing with that? Well, let's say you lived in 1954, and you want to have yourself delivered a new computer. This is what the size of a computer was in the 50s, right? This is your basic home computer. This is the thing you now all have in your pocket, your mobile device, right? It's more powerful than this whole machine. And then in the 80s, IBM came out with the personal computer. Now, the personal computer, as you can see, well, does anybody of you have had a machine like this? Oh, cool. I started out on a Commodore 64, for those of you who know. I still want to get a t-shirt with Commodore 64 on it, though. If you look at the simple configuration of this system, it had 16K RAM, right? Try to figure that out, 16K RAM. My phone has 128 gigabytes, right? That is a magnitude of difference. And this difference makes it that we are now more powerful. This machine was priced at $3,000, right? That is a lot of money for a machine with 16K memory. You would never buy that, right? And then we moved on. So in 2006, Amazon thought that it might be a good idea if we could rent their machines in the cloud. Well, the word cloud didn't exist at that point in time, but they said, well, you know what? Instead of having your own machines, why not put it on our machines? And that made a huge difference, because companies that used to have a lot of computing power used to have a lot of machinery, basically in basements, sitting at banks and government agencies and stuff like that. Huge amounts of hardware, right? And now you could basically enter the field not even running your own computer. And you might think, oh, but that's kind of usual. That's normal, right, these days. 10 years ago, that was not the case. That was really evolutionary, right? Really revolutionary, actually. So what happens is that the enormous change in computing power allows us to do things that we couldn't do before. To give you an idea, I was working for an insurance company. they have to renew their insurance policies every month. Well, 1/12 of the total amount, right? They ran a COBOL program to do that on a huge mainframe. That COBOL program took the whole weekend to run. And if anything had failed, they had to rerun the whole thing. That means that they had to block their system from Monday to Wednesday, meaning the people in the company couldn't work for 3 days if something had failed over the weekend. They spent a day every month in planning the whole prolongation of their policies. Now, at the point in time when I got there, we moved them to a microservices landscape and we moved them to continuous delivery. And at some point in time, one of the developers on my team, a good friend of mine, came into the room and he said, well, I fixed the prolongation of the policies. And we were like, fine, now the code is ready, now we can go out and test it. He said, no, I've just run the prolongation. And we were like, so the CEO of this company, he was like, what? And he said, how long did it take? Because you weren't there yesterday. He said, well, 28 seconds. And they were like, clunk. So the CEO of this company, he didn't understand what happened, right? We just rewrote it on a different scale. We rewrote it in a microservices landscape that could scale up, not on their own machinery, but on machinery in the cloud. Now that means that we can do things that we couldn't do before. And this is a nice example, right? Microsoft has a huge amount of computing power, and they are now using that to help oncologists to find the DNA strings that actually cause cancer. And it is just an arbitrary example of how you could use all that computing power. That means, simply because of the fact that the cloud is there, and I'm not a cloud advocate or anything, I'm just a basic developer, means that the world is changing. And the world is changing fast. If you look at the adoption rate of technologies, it goes faster and faster and faster, right? So before 50 million users used an ATM to get money from the wall, that took a very long time. If you look at more recent technologies, like for instance Facebook, took 3 years because before they reached this number of users. If you look at Pokemon Go, it took 19 days, right? That is a huge difference, and that is where the world is turning to. That also means that in regular industries, like for instance the finance industry, I do for some reason a lot of work in the finance industry, I don't know why, it's just coincidental, I think. If you look at the startup landscape, just here in the Netherlands, there are many, many companies trying to work on something new, something revolutionary maybe, that could change the finance market. Imagine that only one of them, or even one of them, succeeds in creating a new banking system, right? You could write it on some JavaScript component, put it in Node, somewhere in the cloud at Amazon or Azure or whatever you're going to put it, and it'll run, right? And writing such a system is not that difficult. There's a company in the UK that has already done this and is now a certified bank. They employ like 50 people. Imagine that if you're a large bank, and we have a lot of them here in the Netherlands, it would scare me, right? If one of these succeed with 50 people and I have 40,000 people and a lot of hardware in the basement, I'm in trouble. Now, if you look at what the CEO of ING says, for instance, they say, well, it's not the startups that we worry about, it's the Amazons of the world. As soon as Amazon, Apple, Google, Facebook maybe, figures out how to do payments, then the banking market will change, right? Now, look at what's happening. Because of the fact that we have this technology, is that parties from outside of the finance market are now coming into the finance market. Here's an airline. Airlines do payments, right? You can buy stuff in the airplane. You need to these days. Nothing's for free anymore on an airline. And they do payments. And they thought, you know what? We could build our own payment system. Why not? This means that because of this changing technology and this continuously changing technology, we can now enter fields that we weren't in before. Other competitors will come into your field as well, and it will change. As a result, what we need to do is we need to go faster, right? Going faster means basically going smaller, going shorter. It doesn't mean you can have big projects that take 2 years and you finally deliver something at the end of the project, if at all. That era, well, it has never been, by the way, but that era is totally gone. Also, if you're doing agile development now, you will have to move on from that. Agile is good. Moving on from agile, after you've done it for quite a while, is even better. And I'll show you what will happen. So I think what will happen is, well, a couple of things. I think that we will build products instead of projects. I think in the field of software development, we will stop doing projects whatsoever, because the whole project model has never worked for this industry. And it will never work for this industry. I'm going to try to show you that. That also means that if you stop doing projects, there's a lot of other stuff that you can stop, and you'll like that. Also, what I think is we're going to use even shorter cycles. If you're in a Scrum project now, who of you, by the way, is in an Agile project now? Okay, so most of you will have like 2-week sprints, 3-week sprints, whatever, right? That will go. 3-week sprints, cool. That will go away, right? We will stop doing sprints. In the teams I work with, and I'm lucky to work with a lot of teams, I told most of them, unless they really, really wanted these sprints, that there's no need for sprints anymore. And I'll explain that to you too. Thirdly, I think we will have even smaller teams than you're used to in Agile projects. And I've been experimenting with how to work with teams a bit, and I'll tell you a bit about that too. And lastly, I think we will build even smaller components. So this is the part of the talk I will not address. This is about microservices, about serverless computing, about technology mostly. And we will start building smaller and smaller pieces of software. Having a piece of software that you deliver once every month, once every 3 months, that'll go out of the window, because you cannot do that anymore, because you have to go faster. That is in most industries, right? There are some exceptions. So putting this all together, we kind of rephrase that as what we call the continuous culture. This is basically the topic of a book I'm writing together with my girlfriend, Kim, who will be here this afternoon. Unfortunately, her cat fell off the balcony, so she had to go to see the vet. And so she'll be back, and she'll do a talk this afternoon about the same topic. So let's discuss the first one. So basically, what I'll try to say to you is, you don't want to do projects in software development, because that metaphor has never worked. The thing with that metaphor is that it's the wrong metaphor. Well, that's a simple put, right? Let me show you a model, a simple model. It's called the Kinefin model. Now, the Kinefin model was written down by a guy called Dave Snowden when he was working for IBM. He's now a professor in Wales in a university. And he came up with the Kinefin model. And he says, well, basically, you can have problems in 4 different zones. Or actually, there's a 5th one in the middle. But since it's sort of a black hole, you don't want to be there. Basically, if you are in the simple zone, that means you have a problem. You know how to solve it. Go out and solve it. Those are the easy things. We've automated that stuff years ago, right? Everything that we could automate easily, we've already done that. Now, the second zone is what he calls the complicated zone. In the complicated zone, if you have a problem and you put enough analysis on that, you give enough thought to solving that problem, or maybe even figure out what the problem is and then try to solve it, you will be able to solve it. The thing is, in this particular zone, it's that it's sort of plannable. Because if you know how much work it's going to be, you can actually plan it. Right? This is where most companies think that they are in software development. The whole issue is we have never been in the complicated zone. Because things are not plannable in software development. Things change all the time. Technology changes, as I just explained. It changes faster and faster. People learn new things, right? We have to allow people to learn new things. Requirements change. People's ideas change, and they change all the time. Now, the thing is, if you are in the complicated zone and you think your projects are plannable, that means that you have to ban out all this learning stuff, all this changing stuff. And you don't want to ban that out, because if you incorporate that in the way you work, it will actually improve the end result of what you're doing. So this whole model of being in the complicated zone, doing plannable projects, whether they are waterfall or agile or anything in between, it doesn't work. And it has never worked in this industry. We are in the complex zone. In the complex zone, if you have a problem and you know where you want to go at some high level, you could start going in that direction. Once you set a step in that direction, you can validate. If you validate and you're doing the right thing, you can continue in the same path. If not, you have to adjust your path, right? And you have to do that all the time. In the end, you might end up exactly where you want it to be, but it's very much more likely that you will end up somewhere else with a more positive result because of the fact that you continuously adapt to the things you meet. Like, oh, I'm working with Angular now, and for some reason, Bootstrap 3 and Angular don't work well together. Well, they do, by the way, but just figuring it out. And you have to change. Maybe you're moving to React. That means there's a dip in what we used to call productivity, which I think is a nasty and ugly word. And we have to change directions. We have to figure out what to do now. And that is something that you need to do continuously in your project, so to say. But there's also, by the way, the chaotic zone. If you're there, go away. Just figure out, get a different job, move to where it's complex instead of chaotic, because you have no idea where you're going. That means you can try out something, but there's no direction. Some companies work like that, right? They have no clue where they want to be. That means they're just going somewhere, right? There's lots of companies actually who do this, but that's not a good idea. Have some sort of strategy. Try to get there, but you will end up somewhere depending on what happens during the reward. So, if you look at this model, there are some things that you don't have to do anymore. First of all, if you're a project manager, is anybody of you a project manager? Good. So I can talk about project managers freely. If you are a project manager in software development, get a different job, right? Learn how to code. At least, or become a tester and learn how to code, or become a product owner, as most project managers are doing right now, right? Oh, they figure, anybody can be a product owner, let's do that, right? There is no need for projects anymore. Projects, the whole metaphor, does not work in this industry. That means projects, they go out the door, right? That means rigorous project plans, if you have plans like that on your company, go out to the manager, the project manager, the CEO, the CTO, whatever, and tell them, this is not working because of the Kniffen model, because of the fact that the technology in our field is changing so fast that we have a very hard time keeping up. So the question is, what do you do? Well, what I would do is say, okay, I know somewhere I want to go, and I know at a very high level sort of the things that we need to do to get there. And then you pick up the item that is the most valuable to you in whatever sense that is, you start working on that on a very small item, maybe feature by feature, and you work on that, and you put it out there, you look at it, you let your clients look at it, you let your sales look at it, your product management or whatever you do, you let them look at it, you evaluate, and you go back, and you add the next feature or the improvement of your current feature. And you do that all the time. And basically, that is the only process you'll ever need in software development. Right? It's a very, very straightforward process. Now, if you do that, what I learn my teams continuously is I let them ask the question for anything anybody comes up with, and the question is, do we need this now? If we don't need it now, we don't spend time on it. Right? Every team, There's more to do for every team out there in this world than we can ever do. That means you have to make choices continuously. And making choices means not doing the things that you don't need to do right now, right? For anything out there. And that is a big change in how people think. By the way, does anybody know who this is? This is one of my personal heroes, by the way. So in my toilet, I have a gallery of photos from my heroes, and she's in there, actually, this picture. This is Grace Hopper. If you don't know who she is, look her up. She's really, really, really important. She invented COBOL. You might think, COBOL. COBOL is by far the most important programming language in the world, right? If you want to make real, real money, you have to learn COBOL. It's an ugly language, by the way. But anyway, so also what it means that all this estimation stuff you do, you don't have to do that anymore, because if you're not having project plans, why would you estimate? Now, you might think, yes, we need the estimate to be able to scope our sprint. Well, you can let that go too. Basically, you can get let go of sprints, but I'll explain that in a sec. So estimation comes down to this particular law. It's the law of large numbers, and it says it's a theory that describes the result of performing the same experiment, so estimating, a large number of times. According to the law, and it's a law, right? It's not an idea. The average of the results obtained from a large number of trials should be close to the expected value. That means if I flip a coin 10,000 times, with every time I do that 10,000 times, the end result will be very close to 5,000 heads and 5,000 tails, right? That also means that if you do planning, who of you does planning poker? Stop doing that. It's useless. It takes a lot of time and it doesn't add value. Or t-shirt sizing for that matter, or refinement sessions or all that stuff. Just stop doing that. Because basically, if you look at estimation, if you look at estimating story points, whatever they may be, it doesn't add value because counting your items ends up in sort of the same result as doing spending all this time in estimation, right? So you can really, really stop doing that. You can just count the items that you work on. That is enough. According to the law of large numbers, if you have enough items to experiment on, so enough items to estimate, you don't have to do that because you will end up in the average anyway. If you have a scale from 1 to 5 and you estimate 100 items, well, my guess is that the average will be sort of around 3. So there's no value in that. Stop doing those things that are not valuable. So stop estimating and stop doing projects. And I will repeat that until you actually got it into your heads. I also think that Agile has had its longest time. And I'm a strong Agile believer. I've written 2 books about it. I've done it for 20 years. And I think it's time to move on, to move beyond Agile. That basically means that if you look at something like Scrum, this is basically my own handwriting. If you look at Scrum with sprints of 2 weeks and you set up what you're going to do exactly in that sprint, that doesn't really work. Well, it works better than doing waterfall, of course, but it's time to move on beyond that. And especially if you're in a big company and you want to do enterprise agile, is anybody in a company that does enterprise agile? Get a different job. Because enterprise agile has nothing to do with agile. It has to do with trying to scale up a technique that doesn't scale up. Right? And it doesn't have to scale up either. So if you're in a company that does this, is anybody doing this? Yeah, you again, right? Go away, leave your job, right? It doesn't work. It's instead of making things smaller and faster and shorter, this makes things bigger. It doesn't add agility to your company. Or what about this model? Is anybody doing this model, the Spotify model? Cool. Are you working for Spotify? So why are you doing the Spotify model? You are not, right? The whole thing is, if the model works for you, that's okay. The same goes for Save the Game, same goes for Scrum. But it's not necessary that you have to copy somebody else's model, right? Basically, if you're not Spotify, why would you copy the Spotify model? Spotify is a company that doubles in size every year, at least, or a magnitude of 10 maybe, or 3 digits. It grows really, really fast. If you're not an extremely fast-growing company, you do need this model. What I think you should do all the time is keep on thinking for yourself, because it's your company. It's your process. It's your teams. That means you have to figure out what works best for you. Not at Spotify, not at Safe, not at Scrum, or whatever you want to do. Not even what I tell, right? So basically, Agile, does it scale? I don't care. I couldn't care less, basically, because I want to work with small teams, building very small things in really short cycles. That's it. So, next step. Oh, yeah. This is, by the way, one thing I want to tell you is stop doing sprints. Doesn't add value. If you are working feature by feature, you don't need sprints. What sprints will do to you is they let you work in small projects. Like, at the start of our sprint, we're going to have the sprint planning meeting, right? And we do an estimation of how much work you can do in 2 or 3 weeks. And then you try to do that in the 3 weeks. That almost never succeeds, right? This is a good example. I start calling it the red sprint pattern because one of my clients called it like that. This is one of those sprints. They estimate the work. Where's my pointer? Here. They estimate the work, and they're up here. And then they'll break it down until the end of the sprint. But at the end of the sprint, they still have some work left. And then came the next sprint, and the next sprint, and the next sprint, and the next sprint, and the next sprint. After half a year, none of their sprints succeeded. The whole point here is, you don't need sprints to succeed. What you need to do is push out item by item, feature by feature. In that case, why would you have sprints? Those are mini projects that don't add value to what you're doing. So I'd say, stop doing that. And if you look at what the Agile Manifesto says, the Agile Manifesto doesn't talk about sprints or iterations. That's an invention. It's an okay invention, but you could do it better, right? The Agile Manifesto, written in 2001, says to satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of value, of valuable software, right? It doesn't say, have sprints every 2 weeks and try to deliver something. That's not what it says. So we should move on from having sprints in our projects. We should move to doing things continuous. Move to continuous delivery. Deliver everything you can as fast as possible. Doing that means that you have to automate everything. You are going to move in towards a continuous flow. And yes, you can still use Jira. You don't have to, it's not mandatory. A lot of people do, probably all of you do. But you can have different flows. It doesn't have to say to do in progress done. You can just add the stages that you go through with each individual item and push your items through item by item. That is where you need to go, I think. That also means that you have to automate everything. It means you have to have continuous delivery pipelines. In the company I now work for, we do microservices, and we also do micro apps. That means we have over 100 different pipelines. Every one of those can run from checking in my code into production in about 3 minutes. And everything out there is tested automatically. So if you're a tester, which you're probably not, that also means you have to test everything continuously. You have to automate all your tests. Manual testing is out of the door, right? Instead of saying, oh, you know what? I put that slide out. But instead of saying, oh, hey, are you going to wait to do my test and do it manually? I have some Excel spreadsheet that I run through. Before you have run through half of it, the next drop is coming out of the pipeline. That means, oh, I've lost my session. I have to restart again, right? So you have to automate all your tests. Testers have to learn how to write code. That's part of their job, basically, these days, right? Also, it means that your infrastructure, since it's in the cloud anyway, is not much more than a piece of script. We scripted away all our hardware. If we want to start up a complete new environment, it takes about 3 minutes to run. Even what one of the ops guys on our teams did is that if I create a new repository in Bitbucket, he will automatically, without having to touch it, create a complete pipeline for me. Well, he doesn't do this manually, but there's a script for that. It recognizes that there's a new repo, bam, new pipeline. So we automate everything, right? That's the only way out here. So you will end up with, if you even have sprints, like single-day sprints, I'm going to work on this today, I'll deliver it by the end of the day, or halfway during the day. Meetings, stand-up meetings, I've been doing stand-up meetings for 20 years now, they bore me to death. I keep on doing them. I have 4 every morning, right? I try to get away by coming in late to the office. You didn't hear that, Peter. Coming in late to the office so I can skip 2 of them. It's horrible, right? Stop doing all these meetings. Have conversations, right? It's much better. So, and again, right? Stop doing projects. They don't work in our industry. It's gone. So the next step, what about teams? Well, if you look at Scrum, the Scrum Guide and Scrum Alliance and the Scrum whatever you have, they sort of say like, okay, you have small teams like 7 plus or minus 2 people or 6 plus or minus 3. That's very arbitrary, right? If you have a bigger team, you have a bigger team. If you have a smaller team, you have a smaller team. Now, the thing is, what I noticed over time is that we slowly are going into more autonomous teams, but autonomous teams, trying to be an autonomous team, is really, really hard. I'll show you why, and I'll show you what you can do about it. Because I want my teams to be as small as possible. So I'm aiming to have teams of like one, maybe two, maybe three people in it. And they change all the time. I call it micro teams. And why? Well, basically because if you have less people to communicate with, it means you can go much faster. I don't like meetings at more than 10 people. When I got to my current client, they had meetings like 20 people in the room the whole day. And I just said, you know, I'm not going to come here, right? I'm not going to sit in a meeting for half a day just to listen to 20 people talking. That doesn't make sense, right? So I think autonomous teams are fine. And I think we're currently overdoing it a bit. This is the Zappos office. I like chaos, but this is too chaotic even for me, right? And their office looks a bit like this. Or you could do this, for instance. This is a picture from, this is my girlfriend's leg, and she's in a very, very serious job interview at a large retailer. This is not the IKEA, right? This is real stuff. And she said, you know what? I don't believe I can work here. So you can't overdo it. But becoming autonomous and learning for yourself, to think for yourself, is really, really hard. And this picture illustrates that really, really well. This is a herd of sheep, and there used to be a fence here. And what the farmer did is he removed the fence except for the gate. This is us, right? We keep on going through the gate instead of saying, hey, we can go elsewhere. Let's look at what's happening outside of that gate. That is what we need to learn how to do. That's tough because learning to be autonomous is way outside of most people's comfort zone, right? And trying to give direction for doing that is really, really hard too. It's like, well, you have to learn how to draw an owl. You know, you start with drawing two circles and then you figure out for yourself. That is very tough, right? What we figured out is that changing starts with one person doing it differently, right? If one person stops to go to endless meetings and saying, I'm not going to waste any more of my time on meetings that last for longer than 3 hours or have more than 10 people, other people will follow, right? They will try that out too. They will experiment too. There has to be one guy or girl who starts doing it differently. That is how change starts. And that is, I think, what you should do. Try to be that single person. Also, and this is a nice one because this is not too far from here. There's a crossroads in Amsterdam where they removed all the stop signs, they put out the traffic lights, and saw what happened. Now, what happened is, you would expect chaos. That's true. There is chaos. If you go to that crossroads, it's a chaos. But what it learned people to do is instead of following the rules, following the lights, they had to think for themselves. Is it safe for me to cross the road? No, because there's a BMW coming from the left side. Never cross the road when there's a BMW coming from any side, right? And that means they have to get in touch with people who are on the other side of the crossroads. They have to connect. They have to communicate. That is what you need to do. Less rules, communicate better. That's where we need to go. So what I figured out, and I'm going to do this really briefly, because I have like 7 minutes left, is that if you look at traditional teams, in traditional projects, waterfall-style projects, and maybe some of you are still in these kinds of projects, they have different teams for different roles, right? The developers are somewhere on the first floor, the architects on the 20th floor, because they have to be in a tower, and then the testers are somewhere 2 floors down, and the operations people are in the basement, usually, right? Because that's where the mainframe is, and this is how we worked. And then came Agile, and Agile said, well, we are going to work in multidisciplinary teams. And that's fine. I like that. And I've been doing that for a long, long time. That means you pull every one of these disciplines together and have them work on the same thing. That is a big, big improvement. At my current client, it took me, or not only me, but it took us about a year before we got the operations people on board in the other projects. Basically, they were working for a very different department. And we had to talk rigorously to the manager of that department to allow these people to sit on our teams. And we need them there, right? Now, I think that there is going to be a new change to how we work in teams. We are all used to this, right? The 7 ± 2 people in a team, multidisciplinary. What I see over the past, let's say, 5 to 7 years on my teams is that we started to work differently. I usually have like a pool of people that do the work. whatever work it is, right? Testing, development, analysis, UI design, operation stuff, and they're in this pool. Now, for every item that I pull out of my roadmap, I pull out of my backlog or whatever you have, see, I don't have these sprints anymore, I pick it up. Some of the guys or girls on the team during the stand-up in the morning says, okay, I'm going to start a new thing. I'm going to start this one. Okay, I probably need your help. Or somebody else says, oh, you know what? I'm going to help you because I want to learn about this thing too, or I know a bit about it and I'll teach you. And what you'll see happening, I think, is that all sorts of micro teams can arise if you're working in a larger pool of people. My teams at my current client, it's like 30 people in all. And you see them continuously work in different setups, right? For every new item they pick up, there might be different people interested in working on that item too, or know about how to do that, right? So they continuously change. And they change about, I would say, every week, maybe every 2 weeks, when they're working on a new topic, and they change in different setups, and they change again. And it happens all the time. And nobody is telling them how to do that, right? They're sort of autonomous in this, and they can figure it out themselves. And they do, and they like it. And they work with everybody on the team. And the knowledge spreads really, really fast throughout the whole pool of people. Now, that is an interesting development. I started to call that micro teams. I'm not sure it will catch on, but that's the thing I do. And the other point is, always keep on learning, right? You have to figure out new technology, new ways of working, new processes about the domain you're working in. You have to learn all the time. That's why it's so good to go to conferences. It's good to have training courses. It's good to work with different people every time, right? It's good to communicate, even for us as autistic developers that we all are usually. And by the way, if you all do this, you can stop doing projects, because working in a pool of people, picking up the next item from the backlog or the roadmap, not having these cycles anymore, no plans, almost no rules, means that you can actually go much, much faster. So I'm going to wrap it up a bit. This is the short version of the talk. I can do it in 2 hours as well. But we only have 40 minutes, right? So in retrospective, basically, we have been barking up the wrong tree for 50 years in this field. There's a lot of reasons for that. One of them is called waterfall. But we have always thought that we could plan this stuff, right? Project managers who used to be in the lead in projects, they thought they could do that. They took metaphors from outside of our industry, like building a house or working in a factory on a production line, and they tried to implement that in software development. Those metaphors are wrong. Well, they're not wrong for that industry. They are wrong for our industry. Because if you build a house, right, once you build the first floor, it's very tough to build in a basement. If we build software and we've built the first floor of whatever we're building, and we want to change it, we can. And not only can we do that, but you need to do that because you need to improve on the products that you're building, right? That gives us a very different metaphor. That means we have never been in the complicated zone. We are in the complex zone. We have always been, and we will always be there. Meaning you have to be flexible, you have to work in very, very short cycles, with small teams, work on very, very tiny items, and of course, all these traditional projects, they are no more. If you're still in something that is called a project, go out, right? Find somebody who builds a product and start working on that. And maybe the most important thing is, always think for yourself. This is a picture I took of a conference I was in Romania a couple of weeks ago. And it was a quiz. And they asked, well, Ned Stark, some arbitrary person, is a senior product owner. Which approach do you think he will recommend when refining the backlog? And I said, well, all of them can be true. And they said, no, it's answer, I don't know what, answer C, I think it was. You have to say C, otherwise you're wrong. I said, no, if you're saying C, you could be wrong. Any one of these answers is viable. Any other answers are also viable. Why? Because it doesn't say you have to do this. You have to figure out for yourself. You have to think for yourself. You have to find your own approach to doing stuff. Because you are unique. You are not Spotify. You are not the people who implement Scrum, right? It's your company. It's your work. It's your day. It's your life, basically. And as a last thing, what I wanted to say is, okay, even if most of us look like this, okay, if you go to a traditional Java conference, people look like this, even the women. And the thing is, we, as software developers, are in the most important field that is out there. The most important industry is us. That means we have the power to change the world, right? It's us. And that makes this the best field to be in. So with that, I'll leave you. I have 33 seconds left, so I'm on time. Probably because I had a good plan, right? I had no plan at all. So thank you for listening to me. And if you have additional questions, I think there's the Slido application that will show up. Oh, right. Let me read them to you. So first question, when you talk about stopping work for... If you stop stopping work with sprints and instead adding items on the board and move them one by one, is it somehow Kanban? Yes, it is. Does that matter? No, it doesn't. Why do you call it Kanban? It looks like Kanban, but Kanban is not a process. It's not a process you can follow, so that's good. Figure out your own process. Which steps are on your board? If you use a board at all, if you use Jira, if you put it on Post-its, it doesn't matter. What works for you is good, right? That would be the short answer. Aren't no rules too risky? What is too much for you? That is a good question. Well, I think, how do I answer this? I think that in most cases, in most companies, there's way too many rules. So for most companies, we're not yet at the point that we can say we have too little. If there's too little, you'll figure it out, right? Once you're in that situation, you'll figure it out and you'll add the rules yourself. Basically, because you need some rules to guide, right? Like maybe do trunk-based development. Don't do branches anymore. That could be a guideline in my, it's my guideline in my company. It doesn't have to be in yours, but there can be some rules. They are the rules you need, not the rules that traditionally are put onto you, right? That's very different. Oh, there's another one. What's the difference with extreme programming? The difference between what and extreme programming? So extreme programming is an agile approach. Just as Scrum and 20 or 30 other agile approaches out there, it's a very good one. Again, it's a model that might work for you, a model that might not work for you. You have to figure out yourself. Although the technical practices in the technical practices in XP are, of course, we all use the technical practices from extreme programming, so that's good. And the last question is, who's Ferris and why should Ferris be saved? That is a cultural question, right? It's not very hard to find. There is a movie called Ferris Bueller's Day Off. If you haven't seen it, spend the rest of the afternoon downloading it legally and go see it. It's part of your education, right? That's not a rule, by the way. That's a tip. Thank you for being here.